And I'm Michael Hill. Marketplace Morning Report is coming up next. And later on Morning Edition, long after the songs All Star and Walking on the Sun put the rock band Smash Mouth on the map, singer Steve Harbaugh spoke affectionately about those early hits.
People ask me all the time, do you get sick of singing these songs? And I'm like, no. We're proud to have these and perform them every night.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed.
Harwell died yesterday at the age of 56. We'll have a remembrance in about 15 minutes. Right now, 77 with some sunshine is on the way. Actually, it's here already. We have a heat advisory that'll kick in this morning. Today's forecast, mostly sunny and 90 when it again is going to feel warmer or hotter than that, with a slight breeze still. Again, 77 with sunshine at 651.
Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on. Go play. Hey now, you're a rock star.
Support for WNYC comes from Columbia University, programs for high school students, which invite students to Columbia's first ever on-campus fall festival on October 14th. More info at precollege.sbs.columbia.edu/fall2023.
The only thing better than listening to Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me from the comfort of your own home is seeing the show live at Carnegie Hall. Join Peter Sagal and Bill Curtis when they bring Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me to New York City with celebrity panelists and mystery Not My Job guests. Two shows, December 14th and 15th. Tickets at WNYC.org/events.
A cable giant goes up against a media giant.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by Amazon Business. From small business to big enterprise and everything in between, Amazon Business helps simplify the supplies buying process. Amazon Business, your partner for smart business buying. And by Affinity, helping investors navigate the relationship economy with the CRM built for private capital markets. Affinity.co/marketplace.
From Marketplace in Los Angeles, I'm Nova Safo in for David Brancaccio. If you wanted to watch the U.S. Open or college football over the last few days, well, and if you're a Spectrum cable customer, you probably have been out of luck. Disney's ESPN and ABC are blacked out on Spectrum because parent company Charter is in what it considers a defining standoff with Disney. Marketplace's Samantha Fields has more.
Nearly 15 million people pay for cable through Spectrum, and right now they're not exactly getting their money's worth. No ESPN, no ABC, no Disney Channel, and no sense of when that might change. The two companies are facing off over how much Charter should pay Disney to carry its content on cable, and whether Charter customers should get access to Disney's streaming apps for free. This kind of dispute over carriage fees is not new. Channels go dark on cable providers from time to time. But something about this feels bigger. Charter, one of the largest cable companies in the country, is saying the cable TV model is broken. I'm Samantha Fields for Marketplace.
The way we talk about jobs data these days can have a kind of bad news is good news dynamic. For instance, slowing job growth and rising unemployment last month being a positive sign for fighting inflation. But there were also some unequivocally good data points in the August jobs report, especially for women. Marketplace's Megan McCarty-Carino reports.
The share of women in the labor force continues to grow, even faster than participation for men. And the gap between them was the narrowest it's ever been in August, says Lauren Bauer at the Brookings Institution.
Women with young children are participating at much higher rates now than they were before the pandemic hit.
She says flexible and remote work have helped some moms, but another key support is falling away, says Kristen Rowe Finkbeiner with the nonprofit Moms Rising.
There's a childcare cliff happening in September.
This month, billions of dollars in pandemic relief funds for childcare are expiring. I'm Megan McCarty-Carino for Marketplace.
Let's do the numbers. Markets are absorbing yet another data point showing that the world's second largest economy, China, is struggling. A private sector survey shows Chinese services activity growing at its slowest pace in 8 months. The news depressed oil prices. Brent, the global benchmark, is down about 0.7%. On Wall Street, futures are pointing to a lower open.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by C3 AI. C3 Generative AI provides ChatGPT enterprise search that is verifiable, secure, and accurate across all enterprise data. C3.AI. This is enterprise AI. And by Charles Schwab. Schwab believes every investor deserves to work with a firm they can count on, with financial consultants ready to serve clients and 24/7 live help.
ESG has become a loaded term. It stands for Environmental, Social, and Corporate Governance. And it's an investment strategy that considers those factors when assembling a portfolio. The idea has gotten caught up in political tug of wars, but is it a good way to invest? Marketplace's Sabri Benesher put that question to Rich Newsom, Global Chief Investment Strategist at the consulting firm Mercer.
How have ESG funds performed compared to the rest of the stock market so far this year?
We ran an analysis year to date of the 10 largest ESG themed funds as identified by Statista.com. And only three of the 10 had outperformed the S&P 500 year to date. And two of them have actually delivered a negative year to date return, even though the S&P 500 is up double digits.
That's interesting because I recall just a few years ago, people promoting ESG funds were pointing out that they were outperforming just about everything.
During COVID in particular, when oil prices dropped into the 10s or 20s, in general, ESG-themed funds did well. That reversed in 2022 when Russia invaded Ukraine, oil prices went past $100 a barrel, and a lot of ESG investors were surprised that they substantially underperformed the market due to being light in traditional energy.
Central to ESG funds are values, and that has made them controversial, politicized even. They've been the target of Republican lawmakers who claim the funds politicize investment instead of worrying about the bottom line. What's your perspective on that?
So I have a contrarian view that's not popular with either end of the political spectrum, which is that the conversation we're having now in the headlines and with politicians involved about ESG, it's actually the same conversation we've been having within investment committee rooms on the institutional side for more than 30 years. And at the end of the day, it's constructive because it's educating investors that ESG is not one size fits all. There are things to look at here. You need to understand what's in the package and your own beliefs about risk return drivers or impact that you want to have in the world or values will drive you to a different answer. Even within the most passionate, sophisticated ESG investors, there are big differences in belief. If we just take climate change and carbon emissions, there's part of the ESG committed community that believes in net zero and that portfolios should have a net zero commitment and go to net zero. There's another part of the ESG community that is saying, actually solving your portfolio, taking your portfolio to net zero, we could do that tomorrow. That doesn't change the world very much. If you want to change the world, you need to put your money into clean tech and green infrastructure investments. And if you don't do that, we won't solve climate change.
Given the natural disaster after natural disaster that we have seen this year, whether it's wildfires or extreme heat, flooding, hurricanes, E in ESG is environmental factors. Is there any sense that the urgency of this severe weather is drawing more people to consider ESG funds right now?
Definitely the widespread coverage of major environmental disasters. It is causing both institutional and retail investors to think about more carefully, what do we believe will drive security prices, or what impact do we want to have in the world, and can we make money from having that impact? Or are there just values we want to reflect in our portfolio because we don't want to make money off things that are actually hurting the planet, and we'd rather make our money off things that are helping.
Rich Newsom is Global Chief Investment Strategist at the consulting firm Mercer. Thank you, Rich, so much.
Thanks for having me.
And thanks to my colleague Sabri Benesher for that interview. I'm Nova Safo with the Marketplace Morning Report. From APM, American Public Media.